And the last to leave us is death. Death is the last one to leave us, right? It's the final obstacle, the final block is the last one. Welcome to the video. We start out in the mood of confessing that we have a severe continuity problem, which makes understanding very difficult for us. And it makes us go very slow, and we feel we're failing, and we can't get it, and all of this. And yet here we are, looking at death leaving us. Okay, it leaves us. It leaves us. This is very important to look at. Don't try to get rid of death. Don't try to get rid of anything, any of our problems. Don't try to get rid of it. Instead, turn to the vision of oneness. Do your practicing towards the vision of oneness to make a soft landing into it. And everything else, everything that needs to leave, will leave on its own accord. Death will leave. When the vision of oneness arrives, death departs for sure. For sure. Why is that? So let's take a look at that. What is our attraction to death based on? And let's just be clear about this. Everything you see in the world, all the special relationships, those are simply all different, various attractive forms of death. This whole world is simply myriads of attractive forms of death, some more, some less. That's all that all there is. And we are frantically embracing these attractive forms of death, looking for a more attractive form of death, looking for something more beautiful in the world, something that it is more attractive to us. Of course, it's all death. Everything in the world is death. But why do we cling to it? Of course, it's the continuity problem. It's the only reason. So we're focusing on the continuity problem and the remedy to the continuity problem. Once the continuity fear subsides, death will depart from us. We will no longer have an attraction to death. It will no longer seem attractive to us. Why is it attractive to us? Because it's by embracing death, we feel that there's no way we're going to go back to awaken to reality. It's our coma. Death is our nice coma. We're embracing our coma. So I'm not waking up for anything because I would feel I'd lose my identity. I wouldn't know how to what I am or what I need to do or anything. So death is our ultimate crutch. It's what this whole world is manufacturing. Everything, bodies being born here, special relationships, bodies being born, civilization, it's all death. It's all these a parade of attractive forms of death. And after a while, you get tired of all that, and you say, that's not attractive anymore, that's not attractive. But you're thinking, gosh, I just got to find a more attractive form of death because it's all lost its attractiveness to me. And I'm terrified of waking up from my coma. Well, guess what? We don't have to awaken from our coma directly. We have the vision of oneness. And that's just a reminder of reality. A reminder. It's just a reminder. So we get to have a reminder. So when the reminder comes, our continuity fear vanishes. And when our continuity fear vanishes, death no longer appears attractive to us. We cling to death because we say, because that will keep us from awakening. It will keep us from awakening. There's no death in reality at all. It's a potent, potent way to forget reality, to not remember. Potent way to not remember reality. So really what we're doing here is we're just frantically making sure we don't wake up and remember reality. And as such, we constantly pursuing attractive forms of death. So I looked at this very carefully this morning. And it was pretty amazing. I'm not as clear now as I was then, but I was very, very clear about the entire situation and how death will leave you. It'll just leave you. It will leave you. The idea of conquering death is ridiculous. Destroying it, getting rid of it. No, it will flee from you. It will leave you on its own accord. Literally, death will simply depart from you. when you decide that the continuity problem is your only problem and the vision of oneness, only that has value, and you orient your perception towards the vision of oneness, then there's no more attractiveness to death, and it just leaves. You stop projecting it. You know, you stop projecting attraction. You don't have any more attraction to it. So, as we go about our day, you notice that the mind is saying, oh, look at that, or it's trying to, your attention is looking for something that is attractive, you know, more attractive form to hold you as you get close to awakening. And so the discipline is to don't get pulled in by any attractive form of death. All bodies, attractive forms of death. All things, all places, everything, the whole situation here. We just want to embrace it, and we project desire towards it and happiness, and we say, oh, if I have this, I'm going to be happy. This is my child. Death is my child. I need to look after death, you know. Well, it's a device, a delaying device is what it is. It's the final delaying device to go. But it leaves on its own accord. Just departs from you. Just let it go. When the vision of oneness arrives, death departs. I don't have a death problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a death problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a death problem, I have a continuity problem. The death problem has no value for me. Death has no value for me. The attraction to death has no value whatsoever. No meaning, no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has meaning and value. Only the vision of oneness resolves my continuity fear. So, literally, death will depart. And we have to accept this fact. It's going to leave. And it's, you know, it's, that's what I'm aware of, and I'm just sort of trying to, you know, accept it, come to acceptance. Death is going to leave. Very sobering thought, because it's been our buddy for so long. It's our ultimate buddy. It's our ultimate, we think it's our ultimate device. It's our ultimate delaying device. And without it, you know, we think, oh my gosh, I'm going to be so depressed. This is terrible. Death has left me. That shivering, shaking, trembling, hypothermic, fear-based dread, you know, has left me. That's what we look forward to. So it's really a matter of coming to accept that this is going to happen. It's a total different outlook than trying to get rid of it, trying to triumph over. No, it's like death is packing its bags and saying, I can't stay with you anymore. I'll never fall in love with you again, death said. The love affair with death is over. But it was really not a love affair, it was a dependency based on fear, fear-based dependency. We relied on death to keep us focused on self-delusion, projection, to keep us from dropping this insanely whimsical notion we have of that we can change reality. So really, what I'm suggesting is that people remain in the mood of repentance. That's all important, is a sober, somber, serious, non-reactive mood, non-disputing, non-arguing, not going anywhere, because that mood enables us to cope with the shock of all these complexes, the delaying devices leaving us, and even the ultimate one of death leaving us. So I believe it is going to leave me soon. That's what I've seen. It's already got its bags packed. And so it's actually, my attitude is serious, sober, not celebrating, I'm not anticipating or anything. I'm just sort of bracing myself for it. Not sure what's next after that, but I'm just feeling, well, I'll have to cross that bridge, you know, when I get to it. No more death. So I like that attitude where I'm at here. I'm approaching it well, very well, in staying very humble, low-key, and serious and sober, watching my thoughts, watching my attachments, and just it's a big bridge to cross, and you got to be focused and serious, and it's not anything to be taken lightly. That's for sure. So it's almost opposite of what you think. Everyone, you think, oh, I want to be enlightened. I'm really chasing after enlightenment. Just drop the I and you go into bliss. I don't see that at all. I don't see that. Like, it's not like that at all for me. This is heavy, heavy, heavy stuff. Death is leaving me. Death is leaving me permanently. Like I said, I'll never fall in love again. It's never going to fall in love with me again. You know, it's finished. And so, you know, just thinking back all the times we had together, all of them terrible, of course. But, you know, you got to thank your death, you know, and part on good terms. This is what I'm looking at, because it was just a device we were using out of fear. We thought we were going to be annihilated if we dropped this effort to, you know, change reality. And so death actually gave us something to do, kept us preoccupied, made us feel safe, if that's, you know, we can say that, and it's true. So it's, I'm just looking at this, you know, and I'm trying to put out, actually, my whole attitude's changing, trying to put out gratitude towards it, thankfulness, gratitude, thankfulness, self-acceptance, self-forgiveness, but more than just forgiveness. Forgiveness assumes like you did something terrible. No. This was just a device that we projected. Death is just something we projected as a device. And if it's even possible, you know, I can feel something towards it, that, you know, it was quite an adventure, quite a great adventure. And so there's some sort of self-acceptance involved with all of this. Instead of hating yourself and saying, how can I be so stupid? No, just the opposite. Because actually, death is just a symbol of the belief that we have a separate will, that we separated our will. And we didn't. It just symbolizes something that never happened, actually. But we had a lot of fun playing with these symbols, and a lot of adventure, a lot of drama. Playing with death, right? The symbol of separation. So I'm coming around to what I feel is a more mature attitude towards this. And just thanking myself for everything. All the play. Because it was a rational response to an insane idea, to a whimsical idea. So don't blame the symbols. Don't blame the symbols. It was just a whimsical, crazy idea to try and change reality we had. So thank the mind for producing all these delaying devices and symbols. And let the song end on a good note, on good terms. Let the song of death end on a sweet note that we don't have to play that song anymore, because our will has not been split. Our will is unsplittable. Every awareness is unsplittable, is it not? How can you split it? It's everywhere. What meaning does a split have for every awareness? It's split into what? Every awareness and every awareness? So I'm going to try this. It's worth trying. All the attractive forms of death we have chased throughout the ages. So much, so many. Just trying to keep our attention away from the vision of oneness, just away from reality, away from seeing everything as it is, away from recognizing. Distraction is a dance of distraction. It's just, so all of that. Because once we recognize the continuity problem is our only problem, then we start recognizing the remedy for it. Then our fear starts subsiding, and then we don't need death anymore as a distraction. We don't need it anymore. So it's really like that. I feel like I really don't need it anymore. Simply unnecessary. Sickness. I don't need sickness anymore. Don't need death. Don't need troubles. Just don't need them. So they're bound to go, because it's all a projection. If you don't need a projection anymore, the defenses for the projection aren't needed anymore. If you don't believe in split will anymore, there's no reason for all the symbols and the defenses of that, the whole complex of all the defenses to arise. You don't need it. You realize it's just been disassociation. Vision of oneness will heal that. So it's, you don't need it anymore, it's just like that. Outgrown it. It's not necessary anymore. And that's the last to go. It's the big one. is a complex. Death, suffering, sickness, pain. All of that. So, this is a very unique perspective on it all. But it holds promise. It holds promise for me. Which is a good thing, because, you know, it's been hanging around a long time. It's like that tooth that's just hanging by a little thread. And, wow, the last thread seems to hang on and on and on and on. So, at some point, you gotta say, you know what, Tooth, I'm gonna put you in a little jewel box and put you on a shelf and thank you for being what you were to me, a tooth. And so there's some accommodation for it. So I'll try to put a lot of love and gratitude towards it and see what that does. Good humor too. I remember the days when I used to be sick, when I used to be vulnerable, when I used to die. The good old days, not so good old days, but bittersweet memories. It's showing compassion to yourself. How about self-compassion? We talk about compassion to others. How about compassion towards yourself? It's really compassion to others too, because you'll show them the same, but they can have the same attitude. Because you're really giving gratitude to your mind, really. It's the mind that's been projecting all of this, because you told it to. It's possible, you know, to look at it this way, to look at it this way, that death will simply depart us, and that's how it ends. That's how it ends. It departs from us. And we need to have the grace, you know, the grace to allow the departing to take place. If we have the gratitude, what are we left with? Gratitude. We still have the gratitude. See, if we have gratitude now, when it leaves, we still have the gratitude. So that's a soft landing. You see, what we're talking about is soft landing. So what are we landing into? The vision of oneness, which is, you know, just complete gratitude. So we can start right now by the gratitude for all the time that death stayed with us when we needed it, when we wanted it. And now, so as it leaves, we have gratitude for that. And it leaves us, but we still have gratitude for it. We don't need to drop it. I'm still feeling it. And then that can provide a soft landing into the realization that death is not real. It is simply a way of symbolizing what has never happened, which is the split will has never happened. And nobody has a split will. And so all this death and sickness and suffering everybody has, that is only, again, the symbol that they cling to out of fear of the continuity problem issue. And so we will know for sure that everyone is eternal. Everyone is eternal. And see, that's the great vision. You see that in the vision of oneness, is you realize everything is eternal. Everything is eternal life. Just death is just a delaying device, a symbolic delaying device out of fear of they can't remember what reality's like. Well, the vision of oneness is here to remind everyone. But everyone's still eternal. Just because we're afraid we can't remember reality, because they've been denying us, well, it doesn't mean we're not eternal life. We still are. It's just we're we're trying not to remember that. So we're clinging to death, because of course death doesn't remind us of eternal life, does it? It's a way of keeping us from remembering eternal life. So everyone's just like clinging to their death, but it's really nothing. It's really nothing. It's just a symbol. It's just a device that we're imagining. So we see everybody is actually eternal life is all that there is. But first, you have to let your own life, own death go. And as it goes, you see everyone else's death for what it actually is. And so it's like you've lifted death off of the entire universe, actually. By seeing it as it is, actually recognizing what's really going on. Of course, this is a great shift in perspective. It's a shift in perspective, for sure. It's like saying a goodbye to what was never there. Say goodbye to what's never there. It's like the snake in the rope. We say goodbye to the snake, and we say, thank you, snake, for spending all this time with me as a symbol here. And you don't get angry for you're deceiving yourself. Don't get angry at yourself, because it's only your own projection. So if you get angry at the snake, you're getting angry at yourself. Instead, have loving gratitude. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here all this time, being so faithful, so loyal to what I've asked for. And okay, so now I will always remain grateful for that. And now it's time for the departing, and the snake departs, and there you see, the rope, the rope. And you know the rope was what it was all along. It dawns on you accepting it. There's no attack. Don't attack anything. Don't have any attack thoughts. Don't try to destroy anything, attack anything. Don't try to kill death. I know death must die. It means death must depart. But more like death will depart. Death is certain to depart from you. Death is certain to depart from you. And so we have to prepare ourselves for that. That's the real preparation in life, is the preparation for death to depart from us. That is the true responsibility in this life. This is what it's all about. Is prepare for the time when death departs from us. That's a big one. That's a real big one. So I know something's really heavy going on with me. No question about it. My body feels heavy. I know it's super heavy time. Super heavy time. It's a good time for death to depart. It's the right time. It is the right time. A lot of shenanigans are going to happen in the world coming up soon. It is never ending. It's just the form keeps shifting and changing. There we go. Worldwide delivery. UPS Worldwide Service. Well, yeah. Seeing through death in one form is seeing through it in all forms. Experiencing the departure of your own death is really experiencing the departure of death from everything. what's all the fours about? That's death. Number of death, 44. 44 is number of death. It means death. Fourth month, fourth day of the fourth month. Have 644 subscribers now. 6 and 4 is 10, plus 4 is 14. So 4, 4, 14. Today's 4, 4, 14. It's the day that you recognize, you know, that the death is going to depart. For me, it is. That's right. For the world, it may be the day in which the world embraces death to an even greater extent. That is what seems to be happening. But I'll leave the door open for another interpretation. Perhaps there are many who will get it and accept the departure of their own death. That is possible. I'm not exactly sure how it's going to go. Certainly possible. But there is a path of preparation for that, which is this mood of repentance. I have a severe continuity problem. It's all this constellation of realizations and breakthroughs you have that brings about a maturity, a certain kind of maturity. And you're not trying to take away anyone's death. This is very important, okay? You don't say, oh, I'm gonna cure you of cancer, or I'm gonna do this when death departs from you. No, not at all. That's the worst thing, because that's their buddy. That's, for most people, it is the most important thing. They cannot imagine having their death taken away from them. Their sickness, their troubles, their suffering, their death, it is all important for them, because they have this extreme dread and guilt that they think that God doesn't know that they try to replace God and get rid of God. And it's a secret. But they can't remember reality, and they've got this terrible problem. Like, how do I get back to it's like a teenager. They stay out too late, you know. And they're thinking, they keep staying out late. They say, oh, it's past my curfew. My parents are going to kill me when I come home. And they say, well, how can I sneak back in so they don't know that I left? You know, they're thinking. And they stay out longer and longer because they can't figure out a way. So it gets 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning. They're just like trembling and shaking with terror and fear. Like, oh my God, they're going to be so mad. But there must be some way where I can get back into bed and never even know that I left or it's late. And they just, you know, of course the parents know, okay? The parents already know. So God knows, of course, that we try to change reality. And of course we don't remember what reality is like. We've forgotten because we've been trying to forget it, trying to deny it. So we have a continuity problem, and we don't want to admit to God we have a problem, because then God will know. We can't go to, most people say, I can't go to God and say, hey God, I can't remember reality. Because God will say, why? Why? What do you mean you can't remember? What happened? You know, as if God doesn't know we tried to deny it, to change it. So we have this problem. But if you say, hey God, look, I know you're not trying to punish me or anything. I know you're a God of love. You're not harmed by anything I did. Nothing's been harmed or touched. Everything's immaculately perfect as always. I have this continuity problem. I've forgotten. Can you please help me? Then everything's fine. Everything's fine. I remember I met God, the Prime Creator. It was in the presence of God, the Prime Creator, at least one time. And I remember I was absolutely terrified. It was like symbolized by, I went to a door and knocked on the door and it opened up. And I was just like shaking and trembling like a leaf in the wind. And I just said, I just have to do this. And someone symbolizing God was there and said, come on in. Well, you know, beautiful home. And I just hung out for a while and I realized God wasn't the slightest bit agitated, irritated, angry, nothing. Happy to see me, very happy to see me. It's like, and then I realized from that, there's nothing to fear from God at all. Nothing. We just have a continuity problem. That's the only problem we have. We don't have a problem with God at all. Bubbling over with wonderful humor and lightness and love, and just, you know, God was just so wonderful. No anger at all. He didn't say, where you been? You know, where you been all this time? No. He, God knows. We're the prodigal one, you know, that's been wandering aimlessly about. Too afraid to come back home. Too afraid to admit, you know, that we tried to leave. Therefore, unaware that we have a continuity problem, unaware of how to resolve it. And we just keep clinging to death. That'll keep us from even trying to go back home. You know, we think, no, this death saves us. So we don't want to go around healing people, casting out illnesses and all this kind of stuff. No. If it happens on its own, it happens on its own. But you know, if someone's ready for that complex to leave them, it will leave. It will leave whether you're there or not. Sometimes there's something that triggers and they get some confidence and they feel, okay, I can let this leave, this complex leave. That's fine. It's no big deal. But you don't try to take people's death away from them. You just see them as they truly are, as the deathless, immortal ones. And so you're happy. You're happy. You're not. You're among friends. You're among friends. Everybody's your friend, because you see the situation for what it is. Nobody's leaving you. They're just playing this you know, little silly game. They're playing with projections. Think you have to run out and heal people, raise people from the dead and all this stuff. No. Don't interfere with their friendship with death. You know, just those who are saying, you know what, I think it's time that I feel death is getting ready to depart, you know, or it seems like it going in that direction. Okay, then you get some help, you get some teaching, some sharing, some encouragement. And it's just a process. You look at things, and you look at the situation. You try to get, you hone in on the continuity issue, the vision of oneness, qualities of God's lovely living light of remembrance, the qualities of that light, of that experience. You prepare yourself, and you stay in the mood of repentance, and you recognize that this day as it is totally free of all specialness. And you say to yourself, I dwell in a specialness-free past. I dwell in a specialness-free present. I dwell in a specialness-free future. Okay? I dwell in a specialness-free past. I dwell in a specialness-free present. I dwell in a specialness-free future. So where do you dwell? Past, present, and future. It's all one. It's all specialness-free. Take away a sickness from somebody, and what happens? They get some other one, right? Can't live without it. Can't live without it. You can't take death away from people. They'll grab it right back. double it this time. They'll say, wow, I want a whole lot of more of it, because that really scared me. I'm really scared. I didn't realize it could depart from me. That's terrible. I want it back. So the spiritual path, you have to be careful, you know, because you don't want to go too fast and have death depart and say, whoa, this is scaring me too much. Come on, come back. In fact, I want you to bring your friends too. You know, sickness, you know, bring cancer and what other illness. illnesses and diseases or whatever. Bring them with you too. Make sure they all show up and we'll have a big party. So you don't want to do that. So you, when you see everybody, you don't want to say, oh, you stupid people, you can make it depart. Come on, get rid of it. No. It's not like that. Somehow, I guess, people will find that you, I don't know how that works, really. But whatever, just let it happen. Don't have to force anything. And we don't have to feel sorry for ourselves. We don't have to sulk like, oh, death left me. It didn't like me anymore. What's wrong with me? Yeah, something must be something wrong with you. It must be me. It's me. It's not you, death. It's me. Yeah. It's the ultimate breakup, isn't it? It is. It's all me, death. It's not you. No, it's like, it's not me, it's not you or me, we just disagree. It's not you or me, but we just disagree. Yeah. No, it's not that either. It's just that we realize that will was never split. We both say, oh my gosh, it's like, oh, wow. Will was never split. Guess what, mind? You don't have to keep imagining death for me. Isn't that nice? And the mind will say, yeah, that's great. That's great. My will was never split. I just tried so much to disassociate it. How's this evening going? I thought it good to give this little talk, and it's been very good. I could have read all 360 lessons of A Course in Miracles. I went over them all today, all of them. There's some review ones, so it's not quite 360, but just, you know, read them all, and I said, okay, that's very good. But what I find is that the path is like very immediate. What's happening right now, and right now there's this situation coming up. So I need to focus on it. All of those practices somehow had their effect on me. So somehow I'm here now with this death. Is now departing. So that's where I'm at. So I have to deal with that. I can't just say, wait a minute. I need to say this thing, you know. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That happened already. Can't go back again, really. Yeah. Very helpful, all that, but this is the essence of it. It's the essence of it right here, which is the real deal, the real thing. Death departing, that's the real deal. That is the real deal. Now, am I thinking, oh wow, you know, I'm gonna be so, what, this is so great, this is wonderful, I'm gonna be some great guru, great saint or mystic or something? No, I'm not thinking about that really. It's just, no. Much more, you know, sober, humble, and there's a heavy thing. That's really not where it's at, as far as looking at it that way. Because you can't heal people. You can't go cast death out from people again. So, you know, you just encourage people. So, but it's a very tough path, and Not too much room for self-congratulations, really. Because everybody's got the same continuity problem. Everybody has the same problem. It's a very severe problem. Very severe. And people will continue to, you know, hold on to sickness and death, and some for a long time. And there's nothing you can do about it directly at all. So they might not see any value in you at all, really. They might get a little bit, just a little taste, you know, like, huh. So maybe my will's not split. You know, then they think, well, what do I do with death then? What do I do with this? And they start thinking, you know, it's like, wow, I got an issue here. I got a continuity issue. I get a feeling like, oh, maybe someday my death might leave me. I got a big continuity issue. And then they start thinking about it. Yeah, they start thinking about it. So it's not like you can just teach people how to get rid of death or something, because you're not getting rid of it. It's leaving you. And it only leaves you when you no longer ask it to stick around. You don't need it anymore. So it's an indirect thing. The path is, it seems to be indirect. You just keep working on the right stuff, and eventually you don't need it anymore. And the thing about realization is you realize everyone is eternal life. Everything is eternal life. You're not special. You don't attain some sort of specialness at all. So you're among equals. You're among equals everywhere. It's not like Buddha is some, you know, Buddha saying, I attain the highest state, I'm greater than everyone. No. Realization, all life is eternal life. There's only eternal life. It's all totally equal, one totality, one life. It's just one life. There's just one life. That's all. It's just one life. So it's very humbling. It's just that you stop trying to make two lives out of one. That's all. But the one life is still the one life. There's just one life. And so we are it right now. Always now. We can't not be it. We can't not be it. So, wherever you are, whoever you're with, whatever you're doing, It's all eternal life. There's just one eternal life. There's no specialness there. I dwell in a specialness-free past, specialness-free present, specialness-free future. All is heaven, all is well. This moment as it is totally free of all specialness. The past as it is totally free of all specialness. The future as it is totally free of all specialness. I dwell in a totally specialness-free past, present, and future. Sometimes you see people on the path. They're kind of subdued, kind of focused. They seem to be not focusing on things, but trying to stay steady within, non-reactive within. Having awareness, being present, trying to remain present with what is actually the situation for them at the moment. Like they're processing some incredible information, just like, wow, you just heard some news that's just like, whoa, floors you, you know. Really, the path is like you get floored with all these breakthroughs that just floor you, and you just have to sit quietly. Yeah, I just realized death is going to leave me, and I see how it's going to do it. It's fine, and, you know, that it's got to floor you. And so I'm just staying like calm, steady, non-reactive. If you let the emotions get going, then you've got a trouble. You've got a problem, for sure. And I'm sure everyone on the path has experienced that many, many times. Just like a nervous breakdown, just somehow the wheels come off and you just don't know what happened. So we got to guard against that very strictly. Do not get angry or emotional at anybody for any reason. And of course, people will try to bait you into that, for sure they will. They have these, people are marvelously clever and tricky at baiting you into emotional reactions. Because when they're around you and you're in this mood that you're allowing death to depart, they feel their own death, they start feeling like, whoa, you know, some death is departing. I'm afraid. And then they want to stir things up. So someone maybe changed their decision. Get them all emotional and arguments and confusion and stuff. So they feel more at home with all confused and say, oh, I don't know what's happening. You know, so if you're around somebody that is like death has departed from them, you're gonna feel, oh my gosh. And you might think maybe it's departing from me. You know, you get this contact from the situation, like maybe it's me, maybe it's departing from me. Oh no, my God, panic. Not ready for that. And then you try to confuse the issue. So you say, well, I don't know who it's departing from. It's all confused. I'm very confused. I'm very upset. And that's what happens. That's what people do. They stage dramas. They purposefully get all the dust flying, you know, purposefully. And you know that they want you to do that, and then they'll be happy when you do it, but you just can't afford to do that. You can't afford to do that. It's too painful. And it's a tremendous trouble to try to right the ship again. So, stay non-reactive. Be pleasant, be kind. If somebody asked you a stupid question, smile. Be diplomatic. I mean, it doesn't come easy to me, that is for sure. But try and just roll with the punches, okay. And and just put it off. If something you want to put off, just say, okay, oh, sure, and just put it off a little bit. Don't say, no, I don't want to do that. Get in an argument. Just agree. Say, okay, yeah, sure, yeah, we'll try to deal with that. Sure, of course, okay. Stay pleasant mood. Now, other people may keep pushing because they may not want that. But just stay pleasant and then distance yourself from the situation if it goes like that. You may not be welcome, you see. People look at you and say, where's your friend? I say, my friend left me. What? How could your friend leave you? What did you do to your friend, make your friend leave? And of course, they're all hanging out with their friend Death and Sickness, and you don't have your friend Death and Sickness because they left. And they say, oh, there's something wrong with you, you know. They don't want to hang out with you. What's wrong with you? You better go find them. We'll help you find them. Don't worry, we'll help you find them. That, you know, that kind of thing. God bless, poor soul. Without your Death and Sickness, we'll go help. We'll make sure you find them where they are. I'm sure they'll come back to you soon, you know, so. Just call to them. We'll help you call to them. I say, no thanks. What? You crazy? What are you talking about? Because they think that you are going to suffer, you know, the continuity dread, not knowing about the vision of oneness. You can say, no, I have the scrapbook of all the memories. The scrapbook is there, so I don't feel bad about it at all. We had a good time, and they moved on, and got the scrapbook. Now I have a new friend here, Vision of Oneness. So, yeah, no problem. But of course, people don't see it that way. They'll see, oh my gosh, you're so deprived, terrible. Unconscionable. So God will, don't worry, God will help you with that. We'll pray to God and see that you're not so deprived anymore. Literally what they do is literally what they do. We pray to God and say, thank you, God, for letting me keep Death, this wonderful Death and Sickness that you have in store for me in my life. So happy for that. And I just don't want to be too painful, God, but make sure there's some pain there. And, you know, I couldn't live without it. You know, I just couldn't go through life without it, God. Thank you so much. That's really what people do. God's not offended by that. God understands that we have this gigantic continuity problem. We have an honesty problem. We're not honest with God. We're still trying to finagle our way back to reality without asking for help. Because that would admit that, you know, we tried to leave and we don't want to admit that. So, you know, all that stuff. And God knows all that. And God knows that we're trying to pray to God to keep Death with us and all that kind of stuff. But we're just doing it ourselves by our imagination, projecting our imagination. So God's not doing any of it. God's not smiting us, you know. People they're so desirous of, there's got to be smiting in the world. There's got to be all this, you know, terrible death and destruction and violence and smiting and catastrophes because, you know, it makes them feel, it's a great distraction, a great delay device. And so they think that God's providing all this for them. God's doing all the smiting of everything. God doesn't smite anything, but you can't say that to them because they think, oh, I've got to have a God of smiting. So, you know, be careful about that. The path is one of maturing, gradual maturation. You know, just, you know, you have a stage where you feel that's all important, that you need to have a smiting God, and then eventually you know, as your continuity fear diminishes, then you realize, ah, no, that was just a device I was using. But don't try to force anybody out of their position. Just accept them as they are, see them as they truly are, as eternal divine life. Right now, right here, right now, everyone is, without doing anything, without, there's no way they can lose that. Nothing they do changes that in the slightest bit. So everything, right this minute, the past, the present, the future, is all the same. It's all one eternal life, all the same, right here, right now. Thank you. We could say I'm seeing the past. We could say I'm seeing the future. We could say I'm seeing the present. It's all one. It's all one. It's all the same. It's only eternal life is always eternal life. So it doesn't really matter how you put it at all. You're not really seeing now, the present, the past, the future. You're just seeing what's always the case. What is? What is? You're just seeing what is. It's not based on time. But you know people won't understand this. Won't be understood. Doesn't matter. Eternal life is not at the mercy of understanding. It's not like we say, well, I just don't understand it, therefore it isn't. It's not like say, well, I don't, whatever I don't understand can't be true. That, you know, that's not true. So this issue is such a heavy issue that one has to be able to sit quietly and just settle into it, settle into it. It's often good to just stay in your life routine somewhat, you know, just go along, get your dinner and do whatever, you know, just brush your teeth. So most of us believe we have to defeat death. So we don't want to ever come back. It's got to kill it. It's got to defeat it. It's just a device we were using, based on our projection and of split will, idea of split will. If we decide to do that again, it'll come back again. If not, it will not. So there's nothing you need to do to it at all. You don't need to hit it on the way out. You don't need to curse it as it leaves. Just let it leave. Don't go running after with a stick. It's very important. Don't go running after when it leaves. Don't go running after cursing it, chastising it, hitting it, trying to hit it. No. Just let it go. Let it go. It'll run fast, probably. It'll like, you know how someone's really scared, they edge away from you, edge away, acting like they're not really gonna leave you, and then suddenly they just bolt real fast into the bush and just, you know, try to hide and go real fast. It's like that. Just let it go, you know. Let it go. It's gonna suddenly bolt away from you. But I'm trying to not have it bolt away from me. So I'm trying to, you know, have it leave gracefully. Leave gracefully. So there's not a shock, continuity shock of some sort. it's inevitable. Once you do enough, your success is guaranteed. So, apparently I've done enough. Looks that way. It's just a matter of time before death leaves you. It will leave you. Because I just cannot tolerate your attitude anymore. you just don't call upon death like you used to. Just the magic is gone. There's nothing cold as ashes once the fire is gone. And so death sings that song to you. Oh, you just like ashes, cold ashes. There's no more fire there for death. Just don't seek me out anymore. You're just not like you used to be. So that's the consequences. And on a real spiritual path, you know that's what's going to happen eventually. You, in the back of your mind, you know it. That's what you want. You just don't want it to happen too quick. Say, let it not be too quick. This is a big one, you know. So it takes a while, but for sure, that's been my goal, that's for sure. And so it's not surprising at all. I could just sit here, and this is just a good example of you know what the path is all about. It's what it's all about. These delaying devices that we've utilized for so long, one by one they leave us, and eventually the last one to go is death. And we get used to the leaving and realize, okay, we're okay without that. And how it's going to be, I don't know. I just have to, you know, get myself ready for that. Okay. Very great. That's it for this video.